came tonight. Man, I don't know what you came to do, but I came to praise him. I came to magnify the Lord. Give the Lord another hand clap of worship. You don't want to miss Tuesday night. And if you're not a regular Tuesday night attender, I promise you don't want to miss Tuesday night, because we've got a very special guest going to be with us. Brother Caleb Adams, Pastor Adams, will be with us, and he is preaching a very special message by request. And it is going to be helping us launch into our theme for 2018. And he's going to be with us this week. And then for those that are a part of the staff, he's going to be greeting and speaking to you on Friday night as well, helping us launch into a new season beginning in 2018. So we're headed into the holidays, and we want to go out with a bang and start the year in proper form and fashion, headed toward the will of God. Jamalise, wave your hand right there. And where's Sister Myrna? Where's Sister Myrna? Over where? Back in the back. These precious folks, this is Sister Saavedra's mom and sister. And they are from Puerto Rico. And they were in the Rock Church in Moroka a while back and moved back to Puerto Rico. And in the devastation of the hurricane, they have been displaced. Well, we're glad they got displaced back to Sacramento. Amen. This is the Jamalise and Sister Myrna. Big welcome back home. And then I'm looking, I see two good-looking guys I know well. We're glad to have Jonathan and Adriel, and is it Adriel's wife? And two children. That means Brother Eugene Hammonds is old grandpa now. Amen. Give them a hand. We're glad to see them today. Welcome home, guys. Good to see you. We love you. Thank God for you. And all of our other guests, special folks, if we didn't recognize, did I miss somebody? Amen. Oh, yes, I did miss somebody. I'm looking. Sister, all grandmas here from the Philippines. Amen. Good to see her. Hallelujah. Y'all give her a big welcome all the way from the Philippines. Glad she's here. Amen. I see some guests here that I don't know. Give them a big hand. Y'all bless them. I'm glad for everybody that's in the house of the Lord, and all of those welcome by the webcast live stream. Give all of them a welcome that are watching live tonight around the world. Bible, turn to Joshua chapter 1. Amen. I'm going to preach for those of you that were in San Jose yesterday. I hope you're going to preach with me. Amen. I'm going to deliver that bread again. God gave me a message this week, and I'm going to preach it again today. Amen. If this is your first time at the Rock, welcome. Joshua chapter 1. And let's begin with verse number 1. Amen. Now after the death of Moses, the servant of the Lord, it came to pass that the Lord spake unto Joshua, the son of Nun, Moses' minister, saying, Moses, my servant, is dead. Now therefore arise, go over this Jordan, thou and all this people. Everybody say all. God didn't want it to just be a few. He wanted all to go over all this people into the land, which I do give to them, even to the children of Israel. Every place that the sole of your foot shall tread upon, that have I given unto you, as I said unto Moses. From the wilderness and this Lebanon, even unto the great river of Euphrates, all the land of the Hittites and under the great sea toward the going down of the sun, shall be your coast. There shall not any man be able to stand before thee all the days of thy life, as I was with Moses. So, Joshua, I will be with thee. I will not fail thee, nor forsake thee. Be strong and of a good courage, for unto this people shalt thou divide for an inheritance the land which I swear unto their fathers to give them. Skip down to verse 13. Remember the word which Moses, the servant of the Lord, commanded you, saying, the Lord is your God, hath given you rest and hath given you this land. Your wives, your little ones, and your cattle shall remain in the land which Moses gave you on this side of Jordan. But ye shall pass before your brethren armed. Everybody say armed. All the mighty men of valor, and help them until the Lord hath given your brethren rest as he hath given you, and they also possess the land which the Lord your God giveth them. Then ye shall return unto the land of your possession and enjoy it, which Moses the Lord's servant gave you on this side Jordan towards sunrising. And they answered Joshua, saying, all that thou commandest we will do, and whithersoever thou sendest us, we will go. I want to preach for a little while tonight on this subject. Get up and get over it. Get up and get over it. Look to neighbor and say, tonight, you're getting up and you're getting over it. Amen. In the name of the Lord, you may be seated. Joshua is part of what has been called the historical. I've already preached three times this weekend, so I'm no telling what I'm going to say. Y'all better pay close attention. Is part of the historical, would be a better word, narrative of the Word of God, of the Old Covenant, or as we call it, the Old Testament. And the purpose of Israel's history being recorded for us is theological in nature, because it is with intent and agenda that it is included. And it is here that the words of God, the will of God, and the actions of God with his people are recorded and documented for us to recognize how God's people responded in time past. If we are looking at the text and we find God giving a command that is disobeyed, we're to learn from that. We're to look at it and see how did they react, and then continue to read the narrative to find out what the consequence is of their failure to act correctly. If, however, they act in accordance to the Word of God, and that they act appropriately and respond the way God desired them to, we are to continue reading the narrative to see how the blessing of God would flow. So this is why the apostle would write in the New Testament that all scripture was given to us for inspiration and for direction and rebuke and correction and doctrine. So we're to look at these stories like we read tonight to find out how we can apply the Word of God in our own lives. So we look at how they acted and how they performed and how God acted according to their performance, and then see how God will act with our performance when we are faced with similar occasion. So here, let's look at a very monumental time in the people of God and their history. This was a time where transition was occurring. Moses, in fact, the Bible said, had died. He had passed. God had taken him. You know the story of Moses' departure. And it is a time of transition. Israel is now under the leadership of Joshua. And it's going to be a unique type of ministry. He is charged with leading a people after following the iconic leader, Moses. Other than Jesus, I guess it's probably safe to say the greatest leader that ever lived, Moses, that tremendous man that would lead Israel out of Egypt. Now he has led them, and now the mantle of anointing has come upon Joshua. It is a time of monumental change. And you got to understand that Israel in our text is at the very edge of promises being fulfilled. They are just across the water from possession. They are just a little ways away from the fulfillment of God's promises to them. I feel in my spirit tonight that there are people in this room individually and this church body corporately. I got a feeling that we're not very far away from possessing some promises. I just got a feeling there's some men and women in this room today that God wanted me to tell you, you're not very far away from possessing some things you've been dreaming about for a long time. Israel's been wandering for 40 years in that wilderness. They have been wandering aimlessly, and there's been some people that have dropped off, and there's been a generation that has littered the desert with their carcass that has died, but they're right now on the very edge of promise, and they've lost some things. But I got a feeling that somebody in this room, you've been through some stuff, and it's been a long, hard, hot journey, and you may have lost some loved ones along the way, and you may have lost some things that were dear to you. But hear the preacher on this Sunday night that there's a promise just across the way, just around the corner. There's an answer about to show. There was some uncertainty. There was some change. And anytime you've got change, you're going to have uncertainty. And you've got leadership and transition here. And we're going from great Brother Moses to Brother Joshua. We know he's a good man. We hope he can do it. And so they're in this season of transition. And now that great leader's gone. And so there's that emotional stress that comes with transition. But I want you to know that even though they're no doubt in this time of transition and stress and emotional wandering, don't ever forget that even though it's quite emotional, they're literally on the edge of their greatest fulfillment. That's why you got to remember we walk by faith and not by sight. You may be here today in a time of transition. You may be going from one situation to the next, but never underestimate God's ability to take your situation right now and open up a promise for you that you've been praying for. Don't look around you at what it looks like. Just put your faith in God. Joshua receives a word from God. And I like the way God don't play. God don't play. He's pretty blunt. He says, Joshua, Moses, my servant, is dead. Now arise and get across Jordan, which in my lingo is Moses is dead, get up, get over it. You know, I know a lot of people that get hung up. Joshua, you need to get up because I never designed this body of people for a wilderness wandering for 40 years. I built this body to possess. I got news for somebody. I don't care what you're facing, how ugly, how bad, how confused. Remember one thing, God is not the author of confusion. This church wasn't made to wander. This church was made to possess the promises of God.
All right.
So if you've been wondering, it was only for a season. God never intended for you to die in a wilderness. He intended for you to possess a promise that he built for you.
Amen.
So Joshua, get up and get over this Jordan. Shout this Jordan. There is a promise to possess, but you're going to have to get up. You're going to have to get over it. This is the place where they hung up. They have been wandering, and so Joshua, get up and get over it. They were trapped in yesterday. They were wandering around in a wilderness of yesterday. I know people that get trapped in good yesterday and bad yesterday. It's like people that can't move on in life because they're still living all on yesterday's accomplishments. God never intended your past victory for you to get hung up right there and never move to new victory. God intended you to get up and move into the next dimension of what He has for your life. I know a lot of people that are not only hung up, they're trapped in past failures. Can I tell you something? You ain't the first one to ever fall. I know that man or woman on your pew right now beside you, they're dressed up and look good, and you saw them magnifying the Lord. But if you only knew the failures of their life, if you only knew the mistakes they made, you didn't come to a place full of perfect people. You came to a place that's filled with a lot of people that's been through a lot and done a lot and failed a lot and fallen a lot. But we got back up and we understood God never made us to die in this desert. He's got a promise for us to possess. God never intended you for you to die. Failure. Joshua, you got to get up and you got to get over. You know what? Let me be a pastor for a moment. I pastor a lot of people who are 40 years old and are still wandering around. I pastor a lot of 30-year-old people and 20-year-old people. I even pastor some 60-year-old people that ain't got a clue about possessing promises. I come to stir you up. If you are just attending church, nothing wrong with attending church, keep attending church. Because you may show up on a night like tonight and get stirred up and your life, you're ready to attend. Some people in this room tonight, I've already seen your face. You have so much talent. You have so much ability. You're gifted. You've got skills. You could accomplish some great things, but you know what you're doing? You're just wandering around short of promise, just getting through a day, just getting through a week, just getting through another weekend and start the cycle all over again. And you're just wandering, 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 wandering. And you show up and you come back, you go in, you go out, and you never really get to possessing anything great. Well, God got me in your face tonight to tell you it's time to get up and get over. You got all that talent. You got all that anointing. It's time to move in and possess some promises. There's some walls to be torn down. There's some giants that need to be defeated. There's a promised land that needs to be taken. And you better get serious about it, because if you keep wandering around, you're going to die in that wilderness short of what God promised. Some point, you're going to have to get up and get over it. Verse number 10, Joshua said, it's time. So what he does, he commands the officers. He said, I want you to go through the people, and I want you to pass through the host, all the number of the people. He said, prepare them. And he said, within 3 days. Everybody say 3 days. Amen. When I read that this week, I thought, that just kind of sounded like a weekend to me. 3 days, you know, Friday, Saturday, Sunday. And so I just felt like coming tonight and saying, we ain't waiting on another weekend. Some of you have been, you got it out there somewhere. Somewhere out there, I will be used of God. I'll be a soldier and overcome evil with faith. Somewhere out there, it's this general whatever. I'm sick of that. I get tired of hearing about potential. potential, possess. I'd really like to see what would happen if people got rid of that somewhere out there mentality and just made up their mind. I wonder what you waiting on. Well, I'm gonna. When are you gonna? Well, when I get married. Some of you, that may be a while.
Brother, I'm hung up because you're the one that offended me.
get in line. You know what? I'm a man. And I say stuff wrong, like hysterical, when I should have said historical. And I may have missed shaking your hand. And I may have not called on your great-grandchild's birthday that I didn't know about until the party was over. I may have said it wrong, done it wrong, but are you going to let me keep you from your promise?
No.
Let me let you in on something. I ain't letting you keep me from nothing. Somewhere we got to get past all that junk. Let me let you in on a clue. I'm married. And my wife has ticked me off before. Imagine that. And God knows I've got her aggravated before. Yeah, now you know. But you know what? We got through it. Boston, have you and Haley had an argument yet? Philip, you ever gotten an argument with your wife? Not today. I'm not talking about today. Brian, what about you? Yeah. Well, did you give up on? Did she give up on you? Elder Farrell. How long have you been married? You better remember. 43 years. Have you and Sister Farrell always seen eye to eye on everything? Not quite. Have you ever said it wrong? Did you ever do something really stupid and later you were like, why did I say that? Testify, brother. But evidently, 47 years you worked through it. Are you trading her in on a new model? The point I'm trying to make is we don't let those little issues stop us in our relationship with our husband or wife. Why would we even let a brother or sister in this room stop us and get us hung up? Hey, we got to keep working through this thing because there's a promise out there. There's a blessing out there. And maybe the preacher said it wrong. And maybe my brother did it wrong. Maybe we made a mistake right there. But I'm not going to allow that to trap me in yesterday. I'm giving up and I'm getting over that thing. I'm going to get my promise. Don't you let no preacher keep you from it. Don't you let a saint. Don't you let your family. Don't you even let your enemies keep you from your promise. Don't even allow your yesterday failures of yourself. Get up and get up. That's what grace is for. That's what mercy is for. Get up and get over it. You may be seated. So, look at somebody and say, tonight, we go over. There was an awakening in Joshua. That awakening was, all right, it's time. I want you to think about the magnitude of that. The incredible, unbelievable 40 years of wilderness wandering that's all about to change in just a few hours. You think he got excited? You think, I know there was nervous apprehension, but it was like, whoo, let's go over. So he's got this word, and now the word of the Lord comes to him, and I'm going to bring in another dimension. It's going to tie in with what Brother Adams is going to be preaching on Tuesday night. I'm going to preach to some people right here. I want you to look at verse number 13. The Bible says that, he says, I want you to speak to Reuben and Gad, the tribes of Reuben and Gad, and half Manasseh. He said, remember the word of the Lord to Reuben and Gad and half Manasseh. You have already received your blessing. I don't know if you ever noticed this before. Reuben and Gad and half Manasseh, you have been blessed. And you have, because of a prior agreement that Moses and God worked out when you went to Peter, you achieved a first fruits blessing. Before Israel got to cross the land, you petitioned God to possess this land right here at Gilead, right here on this side of the Jordan. There were some people that had received their inheritance before the rest of Israel. I want you to notice what happened right here. He said, all right, Reuben and Gad and half of Manasseh, all you might have been in war, we're crossing over. And you have already achieved your blessing. You've already stepped into favor. And here's what's going to happen. You're going to pass over before the rest of your brethren. And I want you armed. And I want all you mighty men of valor. I want you to get in that river. I want you to cross over before them. And I want you to stand there armed and ready until all the rest of your brethren get over into this promise. Well, I felt the Holy Ghost tell me this week, there's some people that have already moved into blessing. And God said, all right, you got your favor, you got your blessing, but I never intended to be for one guy over here, one guy over there, one girl over there, and one girl there. I intend on everybody getting over into favor. I intend on everybody getting over into blessing. It was never God's will for just Dan and Reuben and half Manasseh to possess a promise. He said, I'm taking everybody over. I came to preach the last part of this message to some blessed men and women. God never intended it for just to be you and a few other people. God wants everybody in this church crossing over.
Why?
So all of you that are already enjoying your blessing, already seeing that nice house and that nice car and that nice business, God told me to shake you up and say it's time for you to help somebody else. It's time for us all to get over there. It's time for us all to get the promise. Maybe see that some of you life has already worked out pretty good. You got that land, you got that family on this side of Jordan, you got the cattle, your location's working, everything's it's all clicking on all cylinders, it's all working out, but he didn't bring Israel this far for you to just enjoy your blessing. There's nothing wrong with enjoying blessing. If you were paying attention, he said, I want you to enjoy it. But here's what God nudged me. I felt the Holy Ghost this week say, we got too many enjoying it too soon. He said, because I want the body, all of my people in the land of promise. Here's what I felt the Holy Ghost tell me. It's time for some men and women who have been blessed to help some other people find their blessing. I lost somebody right here. Because here's what we do. Well, bless God. I did it with hard work and sweat. Let them suckers do it the same way. I know how we are. I grew up in the ministry thing. I started on the music scene. I played the music in the church. Let me just tell you something. All you musicians, listen to me right now. Musicians are some of the most arrogant, self-centered people on planet Earth. That's the truth. You know how I know that? Because they learn a lick and they won't share it with nobody. And all the other musicians, go, oh, that was bad right there. How do you do that? None of your business. Because that's my lick. as if that's their lick. And we always want to be the one that got it. You know, it's mine. It's my song. It's my solo. That's my run. That's my vocal trick. That's my part in the play. Ooh, I feel conviction moving in. Am I telling the truth, Brother Lee? Music teachers hate YouTube. Because all the tricks are being given away. Well, we don't like that. We'd rather accomplish it and just kind of hold it and get all the stars for our ability. But I felt the Holy Ghost say, this is not about us. This is about the kingdom's expansion. And yeah, you can get a lot done with your blessing and your favor and your tricks and your accomplishment. But what would happen if everybody got across Jordan? What if instead of it being two people, what if it was 22 people or 120 people? What if some elderly men that learned about success kind of picked out some young and said, I'm going to mentor him and I'm going to mentor her. I'm going to help them get across. I'm going to show them the tricks that got me across the blessing. I'm going to spend time talking to them and they're trying to learn how to live for God. I've learned a few things and I'm going to take them and get them across Jordan. Well, what about some couples that are looking around and saying, hey, I'm noticing that couple's been struggling. Hey, honey, let's adopt them. Let's take them out to dinner. Let's talk to them about getting their life together for God. Yeah. Reuben and Gad and half Manasseh, you're going to have to go ahead because you've already got your blessing. You're going to have to help somebody. Yeah, you're going to enjoy it, but I don't want you enjoying it until you help somebody else find their place of promise. Verse 15, until the Lord hath given your brethren rest as he hath given you, and they have also possessed the land, then you can return home and enjoy it. Brother Young, I just want to enjoy my blessing. I understand. But there's some other people that need help getting over. And you've got some gifts. You've got some talents. You've got some victories. We need some men that'll take some of these young men under their wing. Say, hey, bud, I notice you've been struggling. I know because I struggled before, but I found the victory. Let me walk with you and show you how to do this. Instead of just showing up and enjoying life and blessing, what would happen if we started helping our brothers and sisters across the world? There's some people in this church that are struggling with addiction. Struggling in their marriage, struggling in their finances, struggling in their whatever it may be. I would almost guarantee for every struggle in this room, there's somebody that overcame that very struggle. And it wouldn't take very much time just to spend a little time with those people. Like an armed elder. And stand in that river with them and say, hey, I got your back until you get over it. I know I want to take this next weekend and go spend on the boat down at Folsom Lake the whole weekend. But I got a burden, honey. I got a burden for that couple. Could we just have them over Saturday and have them out to dinner and let's barbecue in the backyard and let's go get a cup of coffee. Let's just spend some time because I noticed they have been really faithful and I noticed they seem to be struggling. Hey, I want to tell you, if the body of Christ would begin to look out for one another as if you and I never needed, hey, we've all needed somebody to get in that river with us until we can get over. There's some people that need some help getting across the river. than a conqueror. More than a conqueror. You know, I don't know the story. He's friends with people in this church grew up, same ball courts and running around. The story of Kevin Johnson is a pretty neat story. Grew up in Oak Park. Grew up, Marty, one of Marty's best friends. Grew up playing ball around here, mean streets of Oak Park. Back was it, the 80s, 70s, and 80s. He makes his way through a basketball career, winds up Phoenix Sun basketball player, wealthy, successful. He comes back to Sacramento. He conquered the poverty of his community. And he could have stopped and said, I got my check. I got my money. I conquered. But I kind of like the story that he came back and decided to outbecome the man. And if you go to Oak Park, you'll go to a coffee shop, you'll go to a library, you'll go to a theater where Kevin Johnson and his family and I'm sure investors and all that made a difference. And I know that's a carnal example, but I want to show you that's an example of being more than a conqueror. He decided, I'm going to go back to my community and make a difference. You see, I look around at people. Let me just be pastor a moment. I look at people that came out of sin. That now you're blessed. You're no longer addicted. You're no longer bound. You came out of that life that you were in. But I've noticed some of you have gotten real comfortable. And you would think you would look at people that have the same issues you have. And you'd want to make a difference. But you're more content to just enjoy church. I felt the Holy Ghost tell me, some of you need to go back to the neighborhood you came out of and go be more than a conqueror and help somebody else out of that neighborhood. Some of you need to go back to your job and help some of the people that are struggling with the same junk you struggle with. You need to help them find God like you found. The Holy Ghost tell me we got too many people enjoying their blessing while there's some more people that I'm trying to bless. Ooh, I feel a conviction in here right now. You may be seeing I'm almost done. There was something that happened to Reuben Gad and half Manasseh. I like it. I like their answer. Verse 16, they said, the Bible said they answered, we will do whatever you say and we'll go wherever you send us. They bought in. Brother Heffstetler, they said, all right, we got it. We got it. We've been delivered. We've been set free. We've inherited our blessing. We're not only out of Egypt, we've already got our possession. And we want to enjoy it, but we know there's a need. So we're going to roll up our sleeves, we're going to get our battle gear together, we're going across that river, whatever you tell us to do, you can just lead on. In fact, they took it to a whole other level that Joshua never even said. Pay attention right here. In verse 18, they said, you have verse 18? Whosoever he be that doth rebel against thy commandment and will not hearken to thy words and all that thou commandest him, he shall be put to death. Joshua, you go be strong and be of good courage. We got this. Joshua never told them to do that. But I like their attitude. They said, we got this. We see what God's trying to do. Joshua, we see where we're going. We see what kind of land we're supposed to be possessing. And so what we're going to do, we're going to roll up our sleeves, we're going to get our stuff together, and we're going across. In fact, if anybody ain't on board, we're going to deal with them. Now, I'm not telling you to go start killing people. But I am going to make an application. We need some men and women in the church that understand how the kingdom functions, that are not afraid and not intimidated by spirits that rise up in the body to rob the people of revival. And know how to kill the influence of those things that can hinder revival. We go y'all, we got a little deeper right here. There needs to be some men and women that are not intimidated by their peers when their peers get off track and become a hindrance to the body, to look them in the eye and say, hey, bro, you're messed up. Because here's what happens. Let me let you in on some leadership secrets, okay? When the pastor has to draw the sword, there's fallout no matter what happens. Because the moment that happens, people take sides. And they say, well, they don't know the story. Half the time they don't know half the story. And they make foolish choices and foolish decisions. And they feel like they got to take a side. When they don't even know the pastor may be working through a whole lot of things trying to help and alleviate some stuff and get stuff out of the body so it can be fixed and move forward to get up and over this issue. And so what happens is when the pastor has to call somebody in or make a phone call or send an email, what happens then, mom and dad or dad gets offended and that affects mom. And then the kids get affected. And then the best friends, they got to tell about it because they understand something's going on with so-and-so and what's going on with you. And they, well, you know, the pastor, and before long, we got this whole, like, nucleus of trouble. Now, the pastor's got to do that. The Bible tells you he's got to deal with it. But it would be a lot simpler sometimes if just somebody with some common sense would go, hey, dude, don't do that. Why? Because we're trying to have revival here. And in that moment, see what happens? What that does is it frees the pulpit. So here's what happened. If I got to stop, I know we're not running out, but I'm letting you in on what I'm giving you the Holy Ghost word today. When I've got to stop and deal with problems and fornication and rebellion and the spirit of Korah, when I've got to do that, what is that doing for the guy that walked in that needs the Holy Ghost? And I'm having to take a whole service and deal with adultery and fornication and rebellion and gossip and backbiting and issues and sin and rebellion. And I got to do it. That's my job. And I got to stop evangelizing to fix the issue. And meanwhile, there are souls that are on their way to hell that don't even know God. And pastor can't even reach for them because he's having to reach. Meanwhile, they could have been helped by an elder walking up to a young man and saying, hey, buddy, I want to help you get through this. That's the wrong attitude. You don't need to be spreading that around. You don't know what that young lady's been through. You don't know the real story. So before you go talk about all that, spread all that, come on, don't say that anymore. Don't spread that gossip. Don't that ain't nobody's business. Come on, let's live for God. Let's get a call. We need you to get your sword in your hand. Don't make the preacher be the one that always waves the sword. There ought to be some wise men and women that live for God that know how to step up and help the church get across. We need less gossipers and more helpers. We need less backbiting and more encouragement. We need more strength, not more weakness. We need you to get up. If you've already been blessed, if you've already been, get up and get in that river and help us get across. Man, I'm done. Musicians come. I got a feeling we're right on the edge of big promise. God wants to bless this church. God wants to bless your family. God wants to bless you individually. But you got to get up and get over your stuff. And we're here to help you. We're here to help you. God is awakening something in this church. I wish I could take out of my spirit, out of my heart and mind. I wish I could verbally tell you. I can't even really put into words what I feel like God is doing. I can't even wrap my mind around where God wants to take this church. What if everybody? Okay, you're 23. 27, you're 33, and you're still struggling with what you struggled with when you were 18. Get over it. You're 40, and you still act like you're 20. Get over it. You're 50, and you're still intimidated. Get over it. I want to help you. And there's men and women here that God has spoken to while I'm preaching tonight. And there has been an awakening. You know what? The Holy Ghost is, you're feeling that the Holy Ghost is telling you, you're one of those that's supposed to help somebody. I know we normally reach for those that have the need first. We're going to do the opposite tonight. Because I'm one guy. But what if we had an army of men and women that said, we got this? What if, successful businessman, you looked around tonight in prayer and said, God, show me that young man or woman that you want to bless. I'll mentor them. I'll help them. Or you've had some struggles in your life you've overcome. God, put me in connection with somebody that I can help. I want all of you that feel, I don't want mask march, okay? I want only those that really feel like God has spoken to you, specifically to you. I want you to leave where you're standing and come up front. Those of you that you feel like God's hand is on your life tonight, telling you, all right, you got to get in that river and help somebody else across. Come on.